The area of cybersecurity goes beyond just become a technician or a black hat hacker, white hat hacker, red team, blue team. Those aspects of technical aspect in cybersecurity are only one phase that we actually discover or study in computer science, cybersecurity. In reality, cybersecurity is composed of many different other areas, including interdisciplinary areas. This is the Hacker's Corner Adversarial Series. Welcome back to the Hacker's Corner. My name is Christian Servín. I'm a professor here at El Paso Community College. I teach computer science and cybersecurity courses, including the most recently data science or data analytics, including data analytics with AI aspects. So we're very happy to have you here in the show. I would like to thank everybody who has been sending the good information, the good comments and retrievals in the EPCC TV. I want to invite you, all of you who go to the repository of the different shows that we have there, the different episodes. And remember, we're running the Adversarial Thinking Edition nowadays. So I am very happy today to have Dr. Kristine Christensen, who is the co-director of the Educational Pathway Center, who oversees several institutes across the nation, including El Paso Community College. We recently established a collaboration with the EPC in order to expand the different opportunities, not only for the students, the regular students, but also to expand through the K-12. Remember that EPCC, we have a couple of collaborations, including that. Dr. Christensen, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Dr. Servín. I appreciate you having me on your show.
Thank you so much. And thank you so much for all the great work that you have been done in the area, especially in the area of the cybersecurity. Can you tell us a little bit about yourself and all the work that you do?
Oh, sure. I work at Moraine Valley Community College. We're located in Palos Hills, Illinois, which is about 25 miles southwest of Chicago. And at that college, I wear several hats. I serve as a professor in the Computer Information Systems Department as my primary role, where I teach web development, UI, UX design, networking for business, programming, IoT, automation engineering, robotics, and other technologies. Whatever they'll let me teach, I will if I can. But I also serve as director of faculty development, and I oversee the professional development opportunities for our faculty and staff and plan development days for all college employees. But I'm also involved in a lot of cybersecurity grants, which let me meet you. So I work, I've worked for Scholarship for Service. We've had a program on our campus for that. We've done project-based learning incubators for faculty, which focus on integrating cybersecurity concepts into curriculum across disciplines, and specifically looking at critical infrastructure. We were involved in an IoT coordination network. More recently, the NCyTE Faculty Fellowship Program, which helps to build a capacity of diverse future community college educators. And as you mentioned, the Education Pathway National Center, where I serve as co-director, and then get the chance to work with you.
And I am very lucky to work with you as well. And I'm looking forward to expand our collaboration to different capacities. And yes, I forgot to mention that you're a professor as well, on top of all this big resume that you already told us. Very impressive. Congratulations, by the way. When I met you in one of the cybersecurity conferences, and we were discussing about adversarial thinking, and this is one of the things that we're trying to infuse in many different courses, especially because we have partners at every community college. We have partners with industry partners, and we want to infuse this idea. Now, adversarial thinking is not only about technical aspect, about when we develop different techniques or penetration testing techniques or different other techniques that help us to expand this ethical hacking aspect, if you may. Right, but also has a lot of psychological impact and actually humanitarian and social sciences impact. And this is one of the conversations that you and I, we got engaged when we were discussing adversarial thinking. And you have a very nice, interesting perspective about how this can be involved from other non-technical areas. Of course, technical is important, but the other non-technicals are also very important. At EPCC, we have to go through all this cybersecurity training every year. And the majority, like 100% of the times, is always human error, right? And that's something that using social engineering or aspects, that actually, those are the components that permit those vulnerabilities. Can you tell us a little bit more about your perspective, the multidisciplinary perspective on that?
Oh, sure. So I feel like cybersecurity isn't just for those people that work in IT. It's a team effort to make sure that we stay safe and secure and our data stays secure. So that's where the adversarial thinking comes in. So it means asking people to think about how the bad guys might penetrate your network or your system or your process and try to stay one step ahead. So by allowing people to think that way, it helps us understand how attackers might try to break in. So everyone from HR to marketing can help protect our network, devices, and data. And it's all about working together and utilizing our diverse skills and thinking like the opponent, which helps keep our information safe. So that harkens back to there's 52 job roles according to NIST NICE, right? So there's a huge ecosystem and everyone's welcome to, it's an inclusive ecosystem. So you're not just going to be the hoodie, the hacker in the hoodie and the white van outside your house or someone's house trying to gather intel, but you're working in unison with everyone else to ensure that we remain safe. So that's what I like to look at. A professor out of Cedarville University, his name is Seth Hammond, and he really did a nice chart that looked at a broad scope under cybersecurity umbrella. You have the technical and the non-technical aspect. So the technical would be the computer science, where you might have cyber operations and cyber forensics. The engineering, the computer or electrical engineering might have cyber engineering. Those are the technical. Where on the non-technical side, you have your social science, like you mentioned, where you have your cyber human factors. You know, humans are one of the worst attack vectors. We're so easily influenced. And then you have your cyber policy and your cyber legal and ethics. So those are under the social science, and straddling both of those, the technical and non-technical, is the business, where you talk about the cyber IT or you talk about cyber risk management and auditing. So collectively all together, we should be able to work to help combat any kind of bad actor and that might challenge our digital defense. So that's one way to think. So making sure that people not only involved understand the technical mechanics of the systems, but we're engaged in the creative and strategic thought processes that potential adversaries might use. So it's like asking, if I were to breach the system, how would I approach it? And then having that mindset is really critical in identifying and fortifying potential vulnerabilities before they become exploited. And again, we do that all together. So, you know, sometimes the simplest way to penetrate a system is through the human or walking through a door. I mean, it's the easiest thing. You don't have to spend hours trying to find a way into a system. You can just walk right in with a bunch of boxes, relying on people's goodness. So that's where that can sit.
I think so too. And actually, you mentioned the NICE framework. Let's see the NICE framework right here. And you mentioned that there are how many roles, the work roles?
Currently 52. 52. I think they're looking at revising it.
I think so. And when we went to this meeting last, it was a symposium on cybersecurity. They were talking about competencies. And then again, I'm not going to expand too much about that thing, but it caught my attention that you mentioned the NICE framework. The NICE framework stands for the National Initiatives for Cybersecurity Education, right? And that is a framework that allows industry, but also community colleges and four-year institutions to align their curriculum based on these work roles. I think it's fantastic that you mentioned that our EPCC currently identified three of those work roles that will serve the actual community. Do you want to expand a little bit more on that, or
about the work roles? I think it's important for students and people interested in entering the field to take a look at what those work role knowledge, skills, and abilities or knowledge units require, so they can see whether or not that might be a avenue in cybersecurity that they might pursue. Because of the diversity in those work roles, there's a role for everyone. and we need them. So there's a deficit in skilled workers. So trying to get people to understand what those work roles are, what the requirements are, what a day in the life of someone in that role looks like is really important. And there are tons of different resources. I always tell students and even people I talk to when I meet them and we get to talking about it is at cyberseek.org. I think cyberseek.org is a really good resource to look at what those work roles are. So CyberSeek has a heat map and they have career pathways, which identify where the on-ramps and off-ramps of cyber, because no one just starts, I want to be a cybersecurity. Well, they didn't when it was just in its infancy. But now people, there are programs born for cybersecurity. But before, you see a lot of different on-ramps and off-ramps to cybersecurity. That's what sometimes makes it multidisciplinary. When I talk to people, how did you get into cyber? Completely different major, and they found their way somehow, because there's no sector that cyber doesn't touch. I've had people try to challenge me, and I've been able to prove them wrong, because just for basics of like supply chain, how'd you get anything in this world anymore? But the cyberseek.org identifies the different needs in those areas. And they use a nice framework by like the different categories, like operate and maintain and protect and defend. Getting to know that framework is really important, because you'll know where your job sits based on that common lexicon. It was one way to make sure everyone knew what you were talking about, and everyone, it was in alignment with what you expect, and having those knowledge units and making sure curriculum is aligned and mapped to it is really important. But it also shows that, you know, sometimes you don't need a highly technical background. You can just have a business background and be auditing, or you could get your certified information systems auditor or your information security manager certificate. But those are more advanced for the beginner. Easy steps first, but the NICE framework is one way to identify those job roles and see if you like it. And if you go to the NICE website and you go to different websites like WESIS, the Women in Cybersecurity, they do have individuals that are occupying those job roles talk about what their job looks like. What are the requirements? What are the credentials needed? And what are the degrees that you need? The nice thing about CyberSeek also is that you can dig deep and learn what kind of education those job roles require, whether it be a 2-year, 4-year master's degree or doctorate. Coupling that, the years of experience and also your certification needed or typically needed for that type of job role.
Beautiful. I mean, the way you synthesize everything, it makes a lot of sense. And it makes a lot of sense when we were talking about the multidisciplinary aspect. And that kind of breaks the barriers to say, you know what, cybersecurity is completely technical, but if you see all these work roles, like that heat map that you show us to us, it helps more the flexibility of the students and also for the institution where to focus. I was recently in a conference when there is a center for cybersecurity that focuses in cyber law. Interesting, no? Because there's many people believe just let's go and learn all these tools that help us to do phishing things and whatnot. But this was only focusing in cyber law and the social sciences that involves in cybersecurity, which I think expand the entire spectrum of possibilities that students can actually go and study and concentrate, for example. You mentioned HR and business, and I think that's something that right now it's critical for our community and our society, how those they need to think adversarially. I think you mentioned that a couple minutes ago. I just was hoping if you can expand a little bit more on that and that multidisciplinary aspect on cyber, if you may.
Oh, sure. Like, and the beauty of adversarial thinking lies in its inherent diversity. So a technologist might pinpoint a software vulnerability, while like a psychologist could predict that social engineering scam that might happen. Or talking about legal expertise, they might foresee maybe regulatory implications of a data breach, while an artist might be able to visualize that complex cyber threat and be able to design it in a way that the non-technical public could understand it. So if you take all of those things and the varied perspectives together, it could help build a nice resilient defense strategy. So if we go into, like, say, for instance, HR as an example, when you're talking about adversarial thinking and action. So the HR department is a treasure trove of data. So it's responsible for handling, like, your sensitive employee information, including, like, personal details, your financial data, confidential company records. So it's got a ton of sensitive data. So because of that, HR personnel might become prime targets for social engineering attacks. So you need to understand that HR staff are often approached by individuals, like, that are claiming to be employees or job applicants. So knowing that an adversary might exploit it by impersonating an individual to gain trust and access to that sensitive information. So that's anticipating the threat. Then you have to identify what are the vulnerabilities of that department. So you might say HR personnel might not be as tech savvy or might not be as aware of the signs of a phishing attempt or a social engineering ploy. That's not to say they aren't, but some might not be, because, again, remember, humans are the easiest target sometimes. Also identifying the vulnerabilities, like, you could say the department might have protocols for verifying identities, or they might not, or maybe those protocols might be circumvented by a very convincing adversary. So when you start thinking about it, anticipating the threat, having that mindset of adversarial thinking. So anticipate that threat, identify the vulnerabilities, think about how you could devise countermeasures. So can you implement some type of training programs focused on social engineering awareness, specifically tailored, not just a general run, but one specifically tailored to HR to help them with their day-to-day interactions? Or can you establish a multi-factor verification process for any requests for those sensitive data requests, ensuring that those multiple pieces of evidence are required to authenticate identity, and make sure that only then, when they authenticate their identity, can they get the information. And then you might be able to maybe simulate the attack and, like, maybe do those social engineering drills, or have someone send a phishing attempt or make a call to see how that training or the multi-factor authentication or verification process works. And then after each time that you train, you could get feedback from the HR team to say, okay, where are the gaps in knowledge, and where are the areas for improvement, so that you start to create that culture of security. Because only then, and applying that adversarial thinking, can that HR department become adept at recognizing and thwarting those social engineering attempts. And then by having that continuous cycle and anticipating the training and simulation and improvement meetings or the feedback meetings, makes that a more resilient department and less likely to be manipulated by adversaries. And in turn, protecting the organization's sensitive data. So you really want to make sure that you start to employ the adversarial thinking mindset in every sector, because, you know, again, we're, like, the easiest target. Like, I want to help people. You know, my first inclination is to help people, be like, let me help you. Or, oh my gosh, this email has so urgent. Maybe I don't want to get in trouble for not responding to it. But I could be the single point of failure in a threat, which is problematic. And, you know, I like getting paid. I hate to say it, I like my paycheck. So I want to make sure HR has an adversarial mindset to make sure we're all operating and being able to get, I hate to say paid, but the same thing, you could apply that to critical infrastructure. Sure. Like, I like my water and I like my power. So, but again, if you don't have that adversarial mindset, it's not just for the people in IT, it's for everyone. So making it more inclusive and being cognizant of that is really important.
I think you summarize everything very nicely. Adversarial mindset thinking is not only one sector, a single sector, it's all the sectors. Especially right now, everything is connected with one thing and another. At EPCC, we're actually developing, we're offering in the fall, a course called CS0, Adversarial and Analytics Thinking, which actually start to recognize this way of thinking that can help the logistics and help to the students to understand how to build programs. And it's not about too much about programming. It's more about thinking about how, what's your input, what is your expected output, and what can happen in between if you incorporate human errors, context, culture. Even culture is something that might be referenced. You mentioned about social engineering. If someone, you receive that email, and we receive it, we see it every time in those trainings. There's someone who urgently needs you to release some information, and they even, if they use different culture in order to be persuasive, then that can be the weakest link, as you mentioned, that can break the entire organization, or you can put the entire organization on jeopardy. I think you summarize everything very nicely. Now that you mentioned society and aspect, we're organizing with Ring, which is the region. Would you like to talk a little bit about what Ring is? Because we are organizing one of these events that you will come up here to El Paso, and actually we'll bring stakeholders that are in our community, other center of academic of excellence, and also educators and advisors and counselors in order to understand what's the context of this. Can you tell us a little bit more about Ring?
Ring stands for Regions Investing in the Next Generation, and it's a full course for K-12, more specifically 9 to 12, that educates students on cybersecurity. It talks about 9 different areas: ethics, adversarial thinking. They actually have a module in adversarial mm-hmm. thinking, ubiquitous connections. So it's one way to, it's a course that K-12 faculty, more again, 9-12 faculty, can take and use in their curriculum as a full-blown course for cybersecurity. And the effort is to ensure that we build capacity and have a pathway for students to go from high school to a CAE school, whether that be a 2-year or 4-year CAE school. We hope it's El Paso for you, Community College, but it's a full curriculum and it's free. It's really available. It's been vetted very nicely. It's been evaluated and they're continuously improving on it. Additional resources, like we have e-mates, we have a virtual range that people can use that complement the serving curriculum. We have CrypTool courses. So our meeting and our purpose when we visit you is to not only introduce the Ring curriculum to your faculty and stakeholders, but we also have a lot of different resources that complement the Ring curriculum and in hopes to build those pathways so that students get introduced to cybersecurity early. And there are other efforts going to middle school, but we're focused on the high school and create those pathways so that we can build that capacity, because there's a lot of jobs opening. I think globally, I think I want to say it's 2.5 million to 3, it varies. And currently we have a 700,000 job openings in cybersecurity in the US alone, and it's just going to grow. So if we don't address that and create those pathways and get students interested in cybersecurity, that gap, the skills gap will continue and be could potentially be devastating. You know, we need to have people defend and protect our resources and our data and our digital world.
Absolutely. And I think one of the United States, they recognize that there is big gaps there. And it's incredible how this starts from 9 to 12. People say, well, let's learn that when you go to the community college. It's too late. And we can say it's too late. And some people says, well, when I get a master's in cybersecurity, it's too late. I mean, the education starts since the very, very beginning in K to 12. And it's not, it's great that you focus in the 9 to 12 aspects. EPCC, as probably many other community colleges, we host something called the PTECs, which are Pathways in Technologies from the high school. So we host several of those schools at EPCC, and I'm pretty sure this will be super valuable for that community, especially because we're focusing here in the region, but also, as you mentioned, cyber is not only about the region, it's about globally, thinking about all the problems globally. We're very excited. May 16 and 17, we'll be hosting Ring at EPCC, and I want to invite the community also that participate in this great event. There's an RSVP form, as you can see here in the screen. There is a website that has been developed with agenda items and also for RSVP. Kristine, thank you so much for joining us. I think this has been a great show. Do you want some final remarks that you want to say about the activities that you do and the future plans that you have, if you want, if they're disclosable, if, of course.
Oh, sure. I just want to also say that you don't have to focus on a major in cybersecurity. You can complement a major like criminal justice or business or healthcare or automotive with cybersecurity. So that strengthens your ability to be an adversarial thinker because you understand what attack vectors are with respect to your subject matter. And I think that's important. So it doesn't have to be your primary major. It could be a secondary major, even coding too. Like you want to make sure that you understand the aspects of secure code. But then just a couple of things we're going to continue on and ensure that we start developing those pathways nationally. And we're very happy to be partnering with you at El Paso Community College. That's one of the areas that we wanted to go to. So we're very happy to work with you. We're always looking for ideas from the community. So if there's resources that we need to procure to help build those pathways, we're always open to suggestions and ideas. So yeah, and thank you for having me. This has been more fun than I thought it could be.
thank you for agreeing. I know you have a super busy schedule and you're super busy, and good luck with your projects. I look forward to work with you and your team, of course. And I want to thank everybody who has been in contact, and thank you for watching. I want to invite you to EPCC TV. Go to the aspect of Hackers Corner. We have a repository of different shows. I remember that we're running this adversarial thinking edition, so you will find great videos, including this one that you're watching right now in the EPCC TV. And of course, thank you so much for your feedback, for your comments, and for your suggestion. My name is Christian Servín. I'll see you next time, and happy coding, everyone.